गौतम सर, ये 5 साल के बाद में जब ही जाएंगे री रजिस्ट्रेशन के लिए, तभी ट्रस्ट डीड में अमेंडमेंट करवाना पड़ेगा
व्हाई
सर।
व्हाट व्हाई डू वांट टू मेक द अमेंडमेंट?
नहीं, अभी ये लोग 12A के लिए बोलते हैं ना कि दिस 5 डिजोल्यूशन क्लॉज, इन्वेस्टमेंट क्लॉज, ये सब होना जरूरी है।
It may be better to do it, I think, rather than have that problem afterwards.
ओके, so we have to get our trust deed amended.
If you don't have a clause saying that it will on
Yeah,
dissolution go to
because all old trusts are not having this.
So actually it is not really required, but they are insisting on that, unfortunately. And I will cover that revocable transfer thing. I will also cover that whole concept.
Okay.
So that was your question.
Yeah.
So one question and answer.
I think we can start because we have got now the numbers are not increasing. Giriraj ji?
Yes. Bijal, are you there? Yeah. Hi. Over to you, Giriraj sir.
Good evening, members. Today we are with us CA Gautam Nayak. He is the most prominent speaker on the subject. Before we start our session, let us rise for the institute motto. Thank you, members. Today we are with us CA Gautam Nayak, who is going to deliver his lecture on recent amendments for charitable trust, including various compliance. Though he is going to deliver lecture on trust, but our government is not having trust on trust. So they are coming out with so many amendments for trust. And this is the latest one on which he is going to speak. And he is the best speaker on the subject we have. And I don't think he require any introduction, but still I will request CA Bijal Doshi to formally introduce the today's speaker.
Thank you, sir, for giving me opportunity to introduce today's speaker, CA Gautam Nayak. He is practicing as chartered accountant since year 1986. Currently, he is a partner in well-known firm Messrs. E&K & Associates LLP at Mumbai. In past, he was president of BCAS, editor and joint editor, as well as member of editorial board of the monthly journal of BCA, co-chairman of Direct Tax Committee, and member of Finance and Investment Committee of IMC Chamber of Commerce, as well as chairman of Taxation and International Taxation Committee of BCAS. We co-authored books on transaction in shares and securities, taxation and accounting, and taxation of charitable trust published by BCA, and also was co-author of ICI Technical Guide on ICDS. Sir is also contributing a monthly column on controversy for BCA Journal for past 25 years, as well as writes a fortnightly column on personal taxation for the financial newspaper Mint for past 11 years. Apart from contributing articles to professional journals and other newspaper and publications, he also presents talks and papers at seminars and conferences organized by various professional bodies, by corporates and other organizations, and also appeared on CNBC, CNN, etc. as panelists on subject of taxation and audit. With this brief introduction, I would like to present Momentum to be so along with the receipt towards contribution to CABF fund. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation. I'll request you to start the session. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. I think I'll just share my presentation in just a minute. Yeah. So can you see the presentation?
It is loading just 1 minute. Yeah, it has started, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, good evening, members. I think it's a pleasure to be with you to speak on the subject of charitable trusts. You know, recently there have been again another set of amendments, as Mr. Khandelwal said. In the last 10, 12 years, we've been seeing, you know, so many amendments, as if the you know, topic of taxation of trust was not complicated. They have made it more and more complicated, and I think we're seeing a lot of litigation happening in the last 10-12 years. We're seeing on the subject of charitable trust, because the law has been made so harsh that ultimately I think one has to go to the courts to get it to read it down and make it something which is palatable. So that is, I think, one of the problems in recent times. So we're seeing a very negative attitude towards charitable trusts of recent years. And let's see, what are we going to cover today? We will cover the re-registration of charitable trusts, new registration. So when I'm referring to charitable trusts, I'm referring to societies, Section 8 companies also. And, you know, so we're talking about charitable societies, charitable and charitable religions also, of course. So we're talking about all that. Just one question. I think, you know, somebody is raising his hand. I would say that please leave the questions for the end or put them in the chat box. I will answer all the questions that you have at the end. I will leave 15-20 minutes for question answers. So please don't, you know, raise your hands and, you know, because it acts as slight disturbance also in the middle. So that's one request to all of you. So then we will cover the forms and the documents. So what is, and then for 1023C, a similar thing is required. There's an option now under Section 11.7, which you have to choose between 1023C and 11 and 12. How does that option work? Then research institutions under Section 35, which get exemption under Section 1021. You know, so there, I think, you know, again, the same, this is there. For ATG, again, you've got to go in for a reapproval. Then I will deal with certain things, certain amendments which have come in further. One is the statement of donations received and certificate of donation received, which have to be issued by charitable trusts. And the latest set of amendments in the Finance Act 2021 in relation to corpus donations and loans, and when they are to be treated as application of income, etc. And last point is on carry forward of deficit, which again has come in through this Finance Act 2021. So this is what we hope to cover in the next maybe around 1.5 hours is what I will try to cover it in. And, you know, and then we can move on to the question answers. So now, if you look at this concept of registration, re-registration, where did it come from? You know, earlier, the trusts, etc., there was, the registration was with this particular commissioner in each city. For instance, in Mumbai, you had the Commissioner of Income Tax, Mumbai City 4, who would grant registration to charitable trusts. And he would have his own database, it was maintained in a physical form. Some other commissioner in some other place would have his own database, etc. So there was no comprehensive database. And very often, assessing officers could not make out whether the trust was registered or not under Section 12A when they were doing the assessment. So therefore, you know, the CAG audit report 20 of 2013, the CAG said that the ministry may consider providing a suitable database of registered trusts and institutions to an AO for coordination between approving authorities and assessing officers. So therefore, what happened is there we saw on the income tax department's website on incometaxindia.gov.in, we have this database which is there today. So for instance, very often you'll find that you search for a trust, you can search for it by the name of the trust, or you can search by their place and etc. And sometimes you will find some trusts, it shows ATG, but doesn't show 12A. So those sort of discrepancies are there in that, because that, again, that list is not comprehensive enough. Then in between, say in 2016 or 17, the government, we heard talk about the government was thinking of bringing a law for regulation of charitable and religious trusts. In Maharashtra, we have the Maharashtra Public Trust Act. Gujarat, we have the Bombay Public Trust Act as applicable to Gujarat. Rajasthan, we have a law. We have a law in certain other states, such as Tamil Nadu has, I think. But there are a large number of states, vast majority of states don't have a law for regulation of charitable trusts and organizations. There is no such All India law which is there. So therefore, for instance, if you want to set up a trust, on the flexibility, and you have operations in Delhi, best set up in Delhi, because Delhi there is no law relating to charity. You're not governed by any charity commission of $80 rules, etc. Or you go to Bangalore. Karnataka doesn't have it. So that's the way today it was. So there was this, they were thinking of bringing in an All India law, but then I think that was dropped. And then we saw that quite a few changes, in the FCRA regulation, we saw a lot of, tightening of the regulations coming in. We saw a lot of reporting, a lot of disclosures having to be made. And then we had this concept of renewal every 5 years for the FCRA that was introduced around 4 or 5 years back. And now everybody again has to go in for the FCRA renewals. So it was in the light of that, I think, that All India law did not come in, but they're now, I think it seems that decided to regulate trust through the Income Tax Act and through the FCRA. And therefore, I think you have now amendment by the Finance Act 2020, which is further amended by this Taxation and Other Law Relaxation Amendment of Provisions Act 2020. And what did the finance minister say in her speech? She said that in order to claim exemptions, trusts have to be registered with the tax department. In the past, the process was manual and scattered. In order to simplify the compliance for new and existing charity constituents, I propose to make the process of registration completely electronic, under which a unique registration number shall be issued to all new and existing charity institutions. So you have now this concept of unique registration number coming. The question is, this unique registration number is one more number. You have a PAN for individual, you have an Aadhaar, then you have for trust, you have a Darpan ID. And, so now this is one more number which they have to keep in mind. And this number, whether it will be the same throughout or it will change every 5 years, whether it will be the same for 12A, and for ETG, or it will be different, etc. One doesn't know, but that's something which we'll have to wait and see. It will be a 16-digit alphanumeric number, so make it all the more difficult to remember. And then Finance Minister goes on to say that to facilitate registration of new charity institution which is yet to start their charitable activities, I propose to allow them provisional registration for 3 years. Now, what was happening is under the existing 12A and read with section 12AA, one of the things which the commissioner was required to look at was the genuineness of the activities. And certain commissioners took the view that, when you are saying genuineness of activity, you should carry on activities and only then I can conclude whether it is genuine and only then I will give you the registration. That was struck down by various tribunals and high courts. I think unanimously all of them said that applies only if you are carrying on activity. If you have not yet commenced your activity, you are a new trust. Where is the question of you starting your activities and then the commissioner granting you registration? So you can, commissioner is bound not in such cases, he can give the registration looking at the objects. Are the objects genuinely charitable or not? I think he can look at that and he can give the provisional, give the registration. So it is in that light now they've said that, okay, we will allow you immediately provisional registration for 3 years. That is it's in that light that we have to see. And the explanatory memorandum, what does this say? Present process of registration of trust under 12A or 1023C, those 4, 5, 6, and 6A, these are the four clauses which require the approval. There are other clauses where no approval is required. And so they need improvement with the advent of technology and keeping in mind practical issue of obtaining, difficulty in obtaining registration, approval or notification for actually a starting activity, so which is fine. But then it goes on to say, it also felt that the approval for exemption should also be for a limited period, say for a period not exceeding 5 years at a time, which would act as a check to ensure that the conditions of approval are adhered to for want of continuance of exemption. This would in fact also be a reason for having a non-adversarial regime and not conducting ruling inquiring affairs of exempt entities on day-to-day basis in general. As in any case, they would be revisiting the concerned authorities for new registration before expiring of the period of exemption. And this process is to be provided for both existing and new exempt entities. So what they're saying is that we will have, you know, you're being harassed on a day-to-day basis, in assessment proceeding, you're being harassed, etc. We will not harass you every year. We will harass you once in 5 years, is what they seem to be saying. But I don't know how far that will work out because, you know, assessing officers, as you're aware, ask all sorts of stupid questions and, you know, want to make all sorts of additions and, you know, they want to say, well, are you charitable, etc. They want to examine even in the assessment proceedings. So those are problems which one faces. So I don't know whether this will really hold good or not. It's something which is some, you know, if they were to say that, okay, then assessing officer cannot look into these aspects, you know, once you're registered, then I think it will probably have some teeth. It will have some merit in what they're saying. But I think that we'll have to wait and see. Maybe with faceless assessment, things will be better. Of course, I mean, the first round of faceless assessment, one has seen that, yes, generally they have followed the past assessments. If there was an addition made in the past, they've continued the same additions. So the same litigation continues, though there have been, you know, tribunal case laws in your favor, your own cases, etc. So it's unfortunate that they've been doing it, but that's the way it's been right now. So then let's look at what are the provisions that have come in now. So what is the, it says that all trusts who are currently registered, so with existing registration, the provision is that all trusts which are currently registered either under Section 12A or under Section 12AA, you know, the earlier the registration requirement was under 12A. Now the requirement has been that you make the application under 12A and the registration is granted under 12AA. That's for the last 6, 7, 8 years. So either both those categories of trusts have to make an application for registration to the principal commissioner within 3 months from 1st April 2021. That is from 1st April 21 to 30th June 2021, you have to make the application. Earlier, the period was last year's budget when this came. The period was from June 2020 to August 2020, 1st June 2020 to 31st August 2020. That they have now restricted, they've extended it to 1st April 21 to 30th June 2021. With this pandemic and, you know, a complete lockdown from 3rd of April, say, I mean, at least until 15th of May in Maharashtra, for instance, I don't know whether this will possibly need a further extension, I think, because otherwise there will be a, you know, a huge surge of application being made at one point of time. So that's something which maybe the government needs to look at because various states, it's not just Maharashtra, it's down Delhi also, which has imposed a lockdown. Bangalore has imposed a lockdown and Karnataka. So these are things which I think the government therefore needs to look at whether they need to extend. Today, we got a circular extending various other things, but they extended up to 31st of May or 30th of June. But since this due date is 30th June, probably in the month of end of May or first week of June, we'll see some extension coming in if at all it comes in. Now, what happens is they say that in this case, the registration will be granted under Section 12AB for a period of 5 years by the principal commissioner within a period of 6 months from the end of the month in which the application is made. And the application, when you come to the rules, we'll see the application has to be made in Form 10A. There's a new Form 10A which is prescribed, not the old Form 10A. A new Form 10A has been prescribed. And the rules were notified in this regard on 26th of March, 2021. So that you will not find it in your income tax rules book. You will have to download the rules from the site and take a printout and you know, look at it. Or you know, keep it in your laptop, computer and look at it. So in this, if you look at the position that there's under the section, there is no provision to call for documents or make inquiry or satisfaction by the commissioner. So therefore, this seems to be an automatic registration after verifying the earlier registration. And the application is to be online. There's, as I said, there's a new form 10A which has been prescribed. Now, what happens is once you have been granted this initial registration, then at least 6 months before that 5 year period gets over. So before suppose if it's given to you for 4 years, in 6 months before the expiry of that 4 years, Normally, it will, I suppose it will be given for 5 years. So 6 months prior to the end of that, you have to apply for renewal of your registration. Now the registration is under Section 12AB. You know, it was under 12AA so far. Now the registration is under 12AB. 12AA ceases to apply from 1st April 21, and 12AB now will apply. So for renewal, you're supposed to make an application in Form 10AB, and the principal commissioner will call for documents and make inquiries to be satisfied about the genuineness of activities of the trust and compliance of requirements of any other law as a material for the purpose of achievement of its objects. Now, this is there already in Section 12AA. Today, you already have this provision which is there. And when we talk about compliance of requirements of any other law as a material for purpose of achievement of its objects, what are we talking about? Are we talking about the requirements that are material, or are we talking about the law should be material? I think it is the requirements which are material, you know, because the material, the requirements of the law have to be material for the purpose of achievement of objects and not the law itself. So, you know, for instance, in the Maharashtra Public Trust Act, you have a provision for filing a change report. You have a provision for filing your accounts annually. You have a provision for various other things are there. But, you know, at the same time, there is also a requirement, say, for instance, that if you're a charitable trust which is running a hospital, then at least 10% of the beds have to be reserved for poor and needy patients. I think that may be that is a material requirement, but not the requirement filing change report or filing, you know, your accounts, etc. Those are not material for purpose of achievement of your objects. Those are procedural requirements which are there, but it's not material for achievement of your objects. So when you're talking about material for achievement of objects, so those which relate to your achievement of objects, the provision is related to that and not just the procedure. If the commissioner is satisfied about the objects of the trust, the genuineness of his activities and compliance with the material requirements of other laws, the principal commissioner will grant this registration for a period of 5 years. And this he has to grant this registration within 6 months from the end of the month in which the application is made. That's why you have to apply for renewal at least 6 months before your five-year period gets over, so that, you know, there is no gap between the between the lapse of the initial registration and the renewal of your registration. So that is the objective. Now, if the commissioner is not satisfied, your application will be rejected and your registration will be cancelled after affording you an opportunity of being heard. Now, this is a very dangerous provision, which, you know, there is this provision, Section 115TD. What does 115TD say? 115TD says that if you're a charitable trust, a charitable religious trust registered under Section 12AA, and you convert yourself into a non-charitable organization. I think there was some, my internet connection was a little. One second, I'll just stop my video so that, this problem will reduce at least to some extent. So please interrupt me if you feel that you can't hear me, or I mean, if any of the, the conveners, please let me know if, you know, my this voice breaks off in between and it's not clear. So, the point there was about this 115TD. So if you convert yourself into a non-charitable or a non-religious organization, in that situation, they say that you have to pay tax on the fair market value of your assets. And the tax is to be paid at the maximum marginal rate. So if you convert yourself from a charitable organization into a non-charitable organization, you have to pay 42.74% of the fair market value of your assets. Now, those assets may have been acquired, say, 50 years back, and the book value may be 1 lakh, but today the market value may be 50 crores. Now, if that is the position, you will end up having to pay tax on 50 crores at 42%, and you might end up having to sell the property to be able to pay the sort of tax. And, I don't know where that will, effectively, in many cases, the trust we have to close down. You know, that's the harsh consequence of this provision. And unfortunately, I think this is something on which I think one will have to make a representation and hope that over the next 5 years that the law is, diluted to that extent that, merely because the application is rejected does not mean that your registration will necessarily be cancelled. There could be a situation where the registration is cancelled but for political reasons and not because, why am I saying that, 115TD says that if you are charitable and you convert yourself into non-charitable, and there is a deeming fiction saying that if your 12A registration is cancelled, then you are deemed to have converted yourself from charitable to non-charitable, and that is the dangerous part of it. So therefore, that is something which will have to undergo an amendment, because this you may see a large number of organizations where the application will be rejected and they will cancel the 12A registration, saying that this is a thing. So it's unfortunate, that there are sometimes a lot of prejudices, a lot of biases which creep in into the whole process, and it depends on person to person, and then one has to go to the tribunal or the courts. We've seen the recent case of Tata Trust where this 115TD was invoked, and fortunately, I think the tribunal held that, they have 115TD provisions are not attractive in their case. So, but these are the problems which one faces, that there is a lot of subjectivity. And if somebody wants, some officer, some commissioner wishes to harass you, I think, this is unfortunately become a tool for harassment. So if you oblige people by, doing them, giving them favors, as, very often charitable trusts receive requests from the department, for admission in education institutions, hospitals, things, etc. It's unfortunate, but that's the way it is. It happens in our country. And that's something which I think there has to be some sort of a guard against that, because the question is whether a single person can decide that, or whether there should be a panel of people who will decide that, whether there should be an outsider also involved in that, a tax expert involved in that is a question, and which I think, one will have to wait and see. Yeah. So then coming to new cases, when you're a new charitable trust, which has been created now during the current year after 1st April 2021. So a new trust will have to apply for registration 1 month prior to the commencement of the previous year, relevant to the assessment year from which the registration is sought. So which is the previous year for assessment year 21-22, for assessment year 22-23, which is the current year, which is financial year 21-22. For that year, which is assessment year 22-23. So 1 month prior to commencement of the previous year, not 1 month prior to commencement of the assessment year. So if you say 1 month prior to commencement of the previous year for which registration is sought, which means I should have applied for registration before end of February 2021. When the process was not in place, rules were not in place, and at which point of time I was not even in existence. So, which is an absurd requirement. But fortunately, at least for assessment year 22-23, in the rules, there is a clause which I think will tone down the problem, and the problem will not be there, at least for assessment year 22-23. When we come to the rules, we'll see that. So, but the way the section is worded, I think it's a problematic one, and they will have to definitely amend that. Then all trusts whose application under section 12AA is pending as on 1st April 21, where no order has been passed, will be deemed to be applications made for a new registration. So therefore, the question is, pending applications, whether they are automatically converted into application under the new procedure, or whether fresh forms to file, because in those cases, you would already have filed most of these documents which are required to be filed in that situation. Now the question is, I think it's something which one will have to see on a practical situation how this is, because I've at least not come across a new case trust, but the way the section is, it seems that it should be automatic, but one will have to see in other cases where if it was pending, what was the position. But I think the aim, from what I discussed with the commissioner, the aim was to clear off all pending applications by 31st March 2021. So if it is, you have been granted the registration on 31st March 2021, you will have to make an application for renewal of the registration, for re-registration, not renewal of the registration, for re-registration as on 1st April 21 to 30th June 2021. So that is one thing which you have to do. For new registration also, the form is Form 10A. Now, as I said, the question is about the financial year in which the trust is set up. There is a problem for subsequent years. For this year, there may not be such a problem. The provisional registration is to be granted. Now, there's a concept of provisional registration for new cases under Section 12AB for a period of 3 years from the assessment year from which registration is sought. And that is to be granted by the principal commissioner within 1 month from the end of the month in which the application is made. So you make an application, and within 1 month, the commissioner will grant you this provisional registration. And that is valid for a period of 3 years. But we'll come to that. Is it really for 3 years, or is it for a lesser period? And when we come to renewal, when we come to that. Here also, there is no provision for calling for documents or making your inquiry or requirement satisfaction. All you need is a trust deed and the request, registration, charity commissioner, etc., whatever, wherever you're registered. and it's an automatic registration process. Now, when it comes to renewal of provisional registration, so a new case is when your 3-year period is getting over, or now it's not just when your 3-year period is getting over. So you have to make an application for a regular registration, that is a renewal in a sense, 6 months prior to the expiry of period of provisional registration, that is after within 2.5 years, or within 6 months of commencement of activities, whichever is earlier. So if you commence your activities, then within 6 months of that, you have to make the application for a regular registration. So suppose if you have been granted a provisional registration, say you've been formed in the month of June 2021, and you've been granted your registration in July 2021, and you start your activities in August 2021. So by February 2022, you've got to file your application in Form 10AB for a regular registration. And what do you mean by commencement of activities? Because your 6 month period will be counted from there. Whether fundraising activities be covered or only activities in furtherance of objects, in attainment of the objects. And I think, accepting of donations is not your activities, because your commencement of activities from that perspective, I think, would mean the charitable activities. You know, in fact, today, as I said, the genuineness of the activities has to be seen. And genuineness of activities is viewed from the perspective of the spending rather than from the donations received. Because today you will always have an initial corpus which is settled on the trust. You will have some small donations which may have come in before your 12 years granted, etc. But that would not be a commencement of activities. It would be, because obviously you can't start your activities without raising funds. But then your commencement of activities happens when you start your charitable activities. Then the question is, when you start your charitable activities, whether it would be on commencement of hiring of employees or when the employees actually start carrying out those charitable activities. I think it would be the actual start of the activity by the employees. Just hiring of employees would not amount to carrying on activities, because unless those employees really start that work, it would not amount to commencement of activity. Now, in case the activity involves the setting of an institution, say like a home for the aged, for instance, when is the commencement of activities? When you start to look out for the land, when you acquire the land, when you start to construct the building, when you complete the building, or actual start of working of the institution, of the home. So which is the point of time? And, and I would say that normally, in your objects, you say your objects are for setting up of the institution and running the institution. Typically, most objects would have that. So setting up of the institution is also your object. So the moment you start the process of setting up the institution, that would amount to commencement of activities, and that would be, now the practical difficulty is how do you demonstrate that? You'll have to show correspondence, you'll have to show emails showing that, yes, I'm looking out for land, I'm looking out for this. Because in your books of accounts, you may not have any expenditure for that, or there may just be administrative expenditure for that, so that is something which is sometimes very difficult to, convince the commissioner. But I think in law, it would be when you start looking out for the land, I think it's at that point of time itself, your activities would have commenced. Then question is, can you say that you have commenced your activity if you just donated money to another trust? I think yes, because act of donation is also an activity which is one of your activities that to support other institutions carrying on similar activities typically is there in most trust deeds. So therefore, if you donate money to another trust, that would amount to commencement of activities. The question then is, what about delay in application? Would that be fatal to your renewal of registration? I think no, that should not be fatal to your renewal of registration. If it is late, then possibly for us in the interim period, you may not be having a registration. But of course, registration is typically for the full year, so therefore it may not have much consequence. But that is something which the courts also would read it down, tribunals also, because filing the application in time is a procedural requirement. It's not something which result in such a harsh consequence as rejection of your application altogether for your registration. Now, like in the case of renewal of existing cases, it's a renewal, I'm talking about not re-registration, I'm talking about renewal. The principal commissioner will call for documents, make inquiries, or arrive at satisfaction, and after being satisfied about the objects, genuineness of activities, and compliance with the requirements of other laws, then the commissioner will grant your registration for a period of 5 months. And that has to be done within 6 months from the end of the month in which the application is made. There are two more categories under 12AB where you need to now, you also need to And one of them is already there under Section 12AA. You know, and if you amend your trust deed and the objects clause of your trust deed, you're supposed to again apply under Section 12A for re-registration under for fresh registration under 12A. That is there in the existing position also. Within 30 days, you have to apply. And now here also, they have said that if you apply for modify from date of adoption or modification of objects, so within 30 days, you've got to apply for that. So that is similar to what is there under Section 12AA. But there, what you have to do is you have to apply in Form 10AB. So therefore, there will be a detailed scrutiny by the commissioner. What were the activities you're carrying on? What is the your objects? What are the amended objects? Are they charitable, etc.? He will look at all that and then grant you the registration. Now, there is a new category where a trust whose registration becomes inoperative due to application of the first proviso to Section 11(7). Now, Section 11(7), the first proviso, gives you an option to choose between 1023C and Section 12A. And if you opt for 1023C, then your 12A registration becomes inoperative. Now, inoperative is not the same as cancellation of your registration. And they're saying that you can make it operative by filing an application 6 months prior to the commencement of the assessment year. Now, here, this is 6 months prior to the commencement of the assessment year. So for 2022-23, if you want your 12A to become operative, then you will have to apply by 30th September 2021. So that is the and the procedure is the same. He will look at everything in detail, you know, the commissioner, because here also it's in Form 10AB. So Form 10AB is the form for detailed scrutiny. Form 10A is what you call like a 143(1), a summary assessment, sort of summary registration. That's the way I would look at it. Now let's look at the rules for re-registration. So we had existing rule 17A that has been replaced. There's a new rule which has come in. And they said that for re-registration and new registration, you do it in Form 10A. For renewal of registration at the end of that, I mean, at that 5-year period, or for renewal of your provisional registration, which is that 3-year period, or that from 6 months of commencement of activities, or if you want to make your inoperative registration operative, or if you modified your objects, then you apply in Form 10AB. You furnish the forms electronically to be verified by the person authorized to verify return of income. On application, and you know, their procedure is again that EVC or in case you made application in Form 10A, that is for re-registration or for a new registration, the order granting registration will be passed by the principal commissioner in Form 10AC, and you will be issued a 16-digit alphanumeric unique registration number, and which we talked about a little earlier. So therefore, that number will be allotted to you. But for new registration applications made during the financial year 2021-22, the rules provide that the provisional registration will be effective from assessment year 22-23. So even if you make the application for a new registration, you make the application, say, in the month of December or in the month of January or February 2022, you will get your registration effective from assessment year 22-23. So as I said, there's a difference between what the section says and what the rules are, but I think, you know, the intention clearly seems to be to give you this. But the problem really remains for subsequent years, because the rule does not provide for subsequent years what happens to new cases. And the section says that you will get a registration not from the year of registration, effectively you will get it from the next year. That's the way the language is. So that is a problem area which is there. If an application is made in Form 10AB, that is, you know, the cases of when you go in for renewals, or for renewal of provisional registration, or renewal of cases which have been re-registered, or the provisional, inoperative registration, you want to make it operative, or modification of objects. There, it's not just an order granting registration, it's an order of approval, rejection, or cancellation. Either of these three will be in Form 10AD. So in Form 10A, again, the indication is that it is only an order granting registration which will be given. In 10AB, it could be either of the three. It can be approval, rejection, or cancellation. So that is the point which we have to remember. So that is the difference. That in 10A, therefore, it seems that now it is very clearly an automatic process. But you have to just take care that you do your filing properly. Why do I say you have to do your filing properly and mention things properly? Because the registration and URN given in Form 10AC, that is on your Form 10A, can be cancelled at any point of time if Form 10A has not been duly filled in by not providing fully or partly, or by providing false or incorrect information or documents required to be provided under the rules. So this provision is not there for 10 EB, because 10 EB is after details could be formed. 10 EB, because they're saying they're giving it to you on a platter without asking, without looking at things. So therefore, we can cancel it if tomorrow we find out that you've given a wrong statement in that, or you're not providing some document which are required to provide. And therefore, it's, I think it's very important that when you do the filing, please ensure that it is complete in all respects. Please ensure that the information you have given is proper. There are some areas where which are gray areas, and we'll look at that. What are those areas and how we will, how one should tackle it. There is the thing that you know, for cancer, for this cancellation, an opportunity of being heard will be provided. And in, if it is cancelled, then the registration and the URN will be deemed never to have been granted or issued. That means this cancellation is from retrospective effect. So in the next 5 years, tomorrow you could find out that after 4 years, they say, oh, by mistake, you have not given this at that point of time, and therefore we're cancelling it. So for the last 4 years, your whole assessment, everything can be reopened, saying that, you know, this is, of course, subject to the limits now. These are talking about the 3-year limit. So that's something which, and the question which arises is the rule ultra vires the act? Because the act, there is a provision for cancel of registration, and that is only under certain circumstances, and which are specified in 12AB3 and 12AB4. Today we have under 12AA3 and 12AA4, the same identical provisions are there under 12AB3 and 12AB4, that if the trust is carrying out its activities in a manner, you know, which results in violation of 13(1)(c) and 13(1)(d), or the trust's activities are not being carried out in the manner in accordance with its objects. So those are the situations in which it can be cancelled. But now this is something which is new, which has been brought in the rule. It is not there in the section. And therefore, if tomorrow you have a situation where your this is cancelled for any reason, I think this will be a ground for challenge, saying that the rule is ultra vires the act and therefore could not have been done. So that is something which we'll have to you know, keep in mind. Now let's look at the form 10A. What is the form 10A? I think certain things come pre-filled in that form, and you know, like the name, address, the PAN, etc. Those come filled in, pre-filled in. Then you have to select the relevant section code. Now, what are the, there are 19 different categories under which it's a drop-down menu from which you have to select. And, you know, say for instance, under 12A, you have a situation where a re-registration or a new registration, for because this is for form 10A. So what happens is you have to log in into your, onto the e-filing portal, into your account. And under e-filing, you have returns or other forms. You go into other forms, and then under other forms, you select form 10A. When you select form 10A, then it comes in pre-filled over there. It's already pre-filled, and you can store certain information, you can enter certain information, save it, and only when you're finally done, you submit the form. But you have to be careful that you have all the attachments and everything properly filled in before you submit it. So that is something which you need to take care. So the relevant section code is one thing which you have to fill in, and whether it is so 12A1 and 12A, I mean, item number section, this is code, one is for 12A re-registration, and 6 is for 12A new registration. So because form 10A applies only for 12A re-registration, new registration. The same form also applies for 1023C, for 80G, and for 35(1), 2, and 3. So the same form will apply. So therefore, those categories are also there. Under that also, again, there are multiple options. So therefore, you have to select carefully which is the correct option that you're selecting, because the documents that you have to file, etc., all depend upon, you know, which option you select. So then you have to mention what are the nature of activities. And under nature of activities, there's a drop-down menu, either charitable, religious, or religious come charitable. So they have to look at your trust deed. Even if it has charitable, like if you're a religious organization, but it has charitable objects also, then you should select religious come charitable. But you're not really spending on religious scheme, you'll have to show that. Then what is the type of constitution? So the drop-down menu gives you a choice of trust, society, company, or others. Now, in Maharashtra, for instance, you have societies registered under the Societies Registration Act 1860, which are also registered under the Maharashtra Public Trust Act 1950. So very often people say, I'm registered, or I'm a trust registered under the Public Trust Act. Now that is not correct. You are a society. You're a society registered under the Societies Registration Act, but you are also registered under the Maharashtra Public Trust Act. So that is the position. A trust is one which is set up under a trust deed. A society is one where you have your memorandum and bylaws, and you know, you're granted a certificate of registration under Societies Registration Act. So therefore, here you have to select society if you're a society. If you are a trust set up under a trust deed, then only you have to select a trust. then whether you're established under an instrument, because some, if you're an oral this thing, etc., that's the question. So if you're a written document, so therefore an instrument would include a trust deed, a memorandum, an article of association in case of Section 8 company, or it would memorandum bylaws in case of a society. So yes, in most cases, I think you would say yes, established under an instrument. Then date of incorporation, creation, or registration. Now, the question here is, what about in case of trust? Now, in case of trust, what you have is that the trust is created under the trust deed. You apply for registration within the charity commissioner within 1 or 2 months. You apply for registration with the charity commissioner, and the charity commissioner takes one and a half months to give you registration. So your registration with the charity commissioner is typically around 2 or 3 months after your trust deed, you're created under the trust deed. Now, here for a trust, you have to give the date of creation and not the date of registration. For a company, you will give the date of incorporation as mentioned in the certificate of incorporation. Similarly, for society, you will give the date of registration, which is there in the registration certificate granted under the Societies Registration Act, because that is when a society comes into existence. But a trust comes into existence on creation on the, under the trust deed. And therefore, I think it's important that you give that date of creation and not the date of registration with the charity commissioner in that case. Then you have to select the objects, and within objects you have religious objects, or you have to select those various limbs of Section 215, which is relief of poor, medical, educational, yoga, preservation of environment, advancement of any other object of general public utility, etc. So you have to select one of these from the objects. Then the next very important point here, and which we'll spend a little time on discussing that, whether the trust deed contains a clause that the trust is irrevocable. Now, why is this required? If you see the provision of Section 11 starts with the requirement. It says subject to the provisions of Section 60 to 63. And Section 60 to 63 include two things. Section 60 says where there's a transfer of income without transfer of an asset, then the income is to be clubbed with that of the transferor of the income. And Section 61 to 63 deal with revocable transfer. And, so they say that in case of a revocable transfer, the income from that revocable transfer is to be, those assets which are transferred under irrevocable transfer, is to be clubbed with the income of the transferor. So, therefore, a trust will, when it's under revocable transfer, the trust is not, is not entitled to the exemption because the income is chargeable to tax as the income of the person who has settled that amount upon the trust. Now, I think it's very important. I think the basic principle which we need to understand and which I think the department is unfortunately being agitating is that an absence of an irrevocability clause does not necessarily make a trust a revocable trust. There has to be a clause in the trust deed which indicates that it is revocable. It's only then that it would be a revocable transfer. See, today it's like this, that if you make a gift, if you just to make a simple gift deed saying that, okay, I'm handing over this asset to you and it's yours now, then unless you have retained the right to say that, okay, I can revoke this and I ask you to give me that amount back, it does not become revocable. So I have no right then thereafter to ask you to give that back once I've given it to you. So, and you've accepted that gift, that's complete. That's the end of it. So if there's no power retained with the settlor, the trust is irrevocable. Now, and if you look at Section 78 of the Indian Trust Act, what does it say about revocation of trust? It says the trust created by will may be revoked at the pleasure of the testator. And a trust otherwise created, now this is a trust otherwise created because it is created under a trust deed, where the trust has been declared by a non-testamentary instrument or by word of mouth in exercise of a power of revocation expressly reserved to the author of the trust. So there has to be a power of revocation which is expressly reserved to the author of the trust under the trust deed. It is only then that it will be, it can be revoked and therefore it is revocable. Now, also, for instance, if you have a clause in a trust deed which says that on dissolution of the trust, I will hand over, all the assets have to be handed over only to another trust organization having similar objects, another charitable organization having similar objects. But that also indicates that the trust is irrevocable. The assets will under no circumstances will come back to the settlor. And that indicates that, in fact, unfortunately, the way the income tax department says, no, how do we know that the assets will not go to the trustees or the assets will not go to, some individuals. So then you have to point out to them that, see, trust money can be spent only on its objects. What are the objects? Objects are charitable. So it can be spent only for charitable objects. If the trustees take the money, then obviously it is a breach of trust, and they can be sued for breach of trust and for asking for that money back. So therefore, where is the question of that fear? But unfortunately, that is there. And then let's look at a couple of Supreme Court decisions on this. You have in the Ranbir Singh case, Supreme Court, this was a case of private trust, of course, but the principle is the same. And they said the proviso, this was under the 1922 Act, and they said proviso contemplates cases in which there's a provision for retransfer of the income or assets, and such provision is for retransfer directly or indirectly. It also contemplates cases where there's a provision which confers a right upon the settlor to reassume power over the income or assets directly or indirectly. It is the provision for retransfer directly or indirectly of income or assets, or for reassumption of power directly or indirectly over the income or assets, which brings the case within the first proviso. Cases in which there was a settlement, but there was no provision in the settlement for a retransfer of right to reassume power, do not fall within the proviso, even if as a result of the settlement, the settlor obtains the benefit. So they very clearly said that in such cases, unless there is a power to reassume the power, so in the trust deed, there's a provision to reassume the power, then only it is revocable, otherwise it is not revocable. In Jayantilal Amritlal, which was a charitable trust, the Supreme Court said, the words reassume power in section 16(1)(c) as it was under the 1922 Act give indication to the correct meaning of the proviso. The latter part of the proviso contemplates that the settlor should be able, by virtue of something contained in the trust deed, to take back the power he had over the assets or in the execution of the trust deed. A provision enabling settlor to give direction to trustee to employ assets or funds to in a particular manner for particular charitable objects contemplated by trust cannot be said to confer right to reassume. Now, in this, what was happening is that the settlor had settled a charitable trust, saying that he will also be a trustee and he will be the managing trustee. And as a managing trustee, he will have the right to decide for what charitable objects the money is to be spent. So he could say that it is to go to so-and-so school or it is go to so-and-so hospital, etc. So he had that power. So there, the Supreme Court said that no, that is not, he has not, that power is not what is contemplated. Reassume power means he has the power to take it back for himself. That is what. So whatever the power he had prior to the execution of the trust deed, whatever the right over his assets, if he has assumed that right, then it's, here he is bound by the trust deed to spend it for the charitable purposes. So therefore that is, and they said that there was no doubt that the settlor had retained power to see that his wishes were carried out while he was alive, but he could only carry out his wishes within the terms of the trust deed. What he could direct under clause 4 was the application of income to a particular charitable purpose. Similarly, he could nominate a charitable object and fund or investment which could be utilized for that object. This was not a power to reassume control. And then, delegate carrying out a particular charitable object. He could direct contribution to be made to hospital school without obliging trustees to see that they did not misapply the funds. And, the power directions regarding investment have to be subject to the provisions of the Bombay Public Trust Act. He could not, therefore, legally direct a loan to be made to himself. So they said, therefore, he has no right to take back those assets or reassume power over those assets. And therefore, in such a case, it is not a case of revocable transfer. So, but the question here really is this, that say, assuming you have a trustee where the trustee does not state irrevocably. Now, in the past, what the commissioners have been saying is that, you pass a resolution and you file the resolution with us saying that, we will not use that the same for any benefit of the trustees or for any of the settlor, etc. So that is the the resolution is what they asked for, have been asking for so far. But if you want to be 100% safe, because right now, you will be granted a registration, but at the end of the 5-year period, you may be asked for that. So it may be advisable to get the trust deed amended in such situations. And, that you put that power to, say that it is irrevocably transferred so that, that wording is there. It is irrevocably transferred and that, and even if you don't have saying that on dissolution, it will be given to some similar institution, put that in. I think it's advisable. So far as company, Section 8 companies are concerned, I think very clearly there is a requirement to have that. Similarly, under the Societies Registration Act also, under the Societies Registration Act itself, there is a provision that you cannot give the assets cannot be distributed amongst the members, but assets have to be given to another society having similar objects. So therefore, I think that is something which is already there in the law. But unfortunately, the department has been insisting that you have to put it into the deed itself. So that is something which, if you want to avoid litigation, maybe one should amend the trust deed, get it modified. But otherwise also, I mean, I think one has a strong case for saying that unless there is a power of revocation, it cannot be regarded as a revocable transfer, because it has to be used only for charitable purposes, either the corpus as well as the money cannot come back to the trustee, to the settlor under any circumstances, nor can it go to the trustees. Then coming to the next point, is it registered on the Darpan, whether it's registered on the Darpan portal under the FCRA or any provision of the Income Tax Act? And if so, give the registration number, date of registration, authority granting registration, and date from which the registration is effective. So you have to give all these. So for instance, if you're making, even making application at 12A, you should give your 12A registration, give your ATG registration, give your FCRA registration, and give your Darpan portal registration details, if it is there. But Darpan portal registration details are mandatory only if you're receiving or entitled to receive any grant or assessment from central or state government. Otherwise, it's not mandatory, is what the it's been clarified in the notes, which are, see, there are a lot of notes attached to the forms, and I think one should read those notes. I think very often, I think it gives you a clue as to what's to be done. The notes are in a very convoluted manner, because if you are selecting so-and-so, then this is the position. If you're not selecting, then this will be the position. So you have to look at that particular row, particular clause, and then read it along with that. Then the next question which you ask is whether you have made any application in the past and which has been rejected. Now, there are many cases where the 12A registration has been rejected in the past, but they have been allowed an appeal to the tribunal, or in writ petition, the courts have directed that 12A registration should be granted. What should be your answer here? I think here your answer should be that no, in that situation, because then the order of rejection no longer survives. Once the court or the tribunal has struck it down, it no longer survives. And therefore, it will not amount to, you know, and you don't have to answer yes over here, because very clearly, it is not an order of rejection which is valid. But if it was rejected, and then because, say, for instance, you had said that you had not commenced your activities, and then again you had applied and you got your 12A, then you'll have to mention that, okay, yes, this was rejected at this point of time, and it was on this ground. So therefore, I think then you should mention that, because you had not started your activities. So that is in that situation. You'll have to attach a copy of that, and that will very clearly bring out that it was only because you had not started your activities, and you had not gone an appeal maybe against that, and you prefer to file an application later on. So in those tax situation, you can. Then you're supposed to give the details of the author, founder, settler, trustees, members of the society, members of the governing council, directors, shareholders holding 5% or more shareholding, that will apply in Section 8 company, or office bearers on the date of the application. Now, very often you have the settler is also a trustee. So then you should give his name twice, once as the settler and once as the trustee. I think that's the way you should look at it. For each of these, you're supposed to give what is the name, what is the relation, that is under which category, is it settler, is it a trustee, is it office bearer, whatever the thing. Then the unique identification number. So unique identification number is either the PAN or the Aadhaar, and which of them are you giving, PAN or Aadhaar? The ID code is 1 or 2, which is PAN or Aadhaar, depending on what you're giving. Then the address, mobile number, and email address of that particular person. And if any of those, say for instance, the shareholder holding 5% or more is not an individual, say it's a society, then if there are any natural persons who are beneficial owners of 5% or more of that society, then also you're supposed to give that. That also is required to be given. The next question is whether the return of income filed for the last assessment year for which the due date of filing of return has expired, has it been filed? And this field is auto-populated. So if you file your returns for assessment year 2021, it is auto-populated. But you know, in case you have a problem there, if you file a belated return, now what happens if you file a belated return? You lose your exemption under Section 11 and 12 for that particular year. But a belated return is also a valid return. So therefore, all the exemption may not have been available. So now, for instance, you've not filed the return of the trust for assessment year 2021. You can still do it up to 31st May 2021. Because belated return, the time limit has been extended to 31st May. So do it by 31st May, and then you can file your, the application is what I would advise. It's also, because in that return, you would have given full details, of the accounts, etc. You would have given. So therefore, it is also a valid return. Now, the question is, if the return has not been filed, can the application be rejected? No, that's not the purpose. The application will be accepted, but there are certain additional details you're supposed to give if your return if it has not been filed, and what are those things that you're required to give. You're supposed to give financial details as on the date of application. That is corpus, funds and reserves and surplus other than corpus, long-term liabilities, other liabilities, land and building, other fixed assets, investments or deposits in mode specified in section 11.5, and other investments or deposits and other assets. So you're supposed to give these details. And you're supposed to give details of income in the immediately three preceding years. What are the grants from central or state government, grants from companies received under CSR, other specific grants, and other income. Now, other income would include general donations, it would include interest income, it could include all sorts of other miscellaneous income. So that was what will come in. But all this is required to be given only if you're making an application for fresh register of approval under 12AB, 1023 or 80G. And the return of income has gone. So it's a fresh registration, that's a new cases. Or if it's an application for, and the return has not been filed. So it's only if the return file that is required to give this, these details. So that is one thing which you need to keep in mind. So look at the notes very carefully and whether you are required to give the details. There are quite a few issues over there which arise in respect to these financial details. There's a practical difficulty in giving details on the date of application. There is no time gap around this as on the date of application. Now, obviously, on a day-to-day basis, the figures would change. Other assets, for instance, your bank balances would change on a day-to-day basis. At the beginning of the day, it may be different. At the end of the day, it may be different. So I think a reasonable period should have been mentioned. I mean, practically, I think, if it's in the last fortnight or a month also, I think it should be acceptable. But one will have to, I think, there is a problem over there because they will have to come up with some clarification on that. Then the question is, what about capital funds such as building fund? Should these be shown as corpus or funds, reserves or surplus other than corpus? Now, a building fund is for a capital purpose. So any fund which is for a capital purpose and you receive a donation towards that fund, that is a corpus fund. So therefore, that will have to be classified as corpus and not as other than corpus. The question is, do you have to show liability if you're following cash method of accounting? I think the objective here is because you've not filed your return, we don't have your accounts and all that. So I don't think you're required to show your liability if you're following cash method of accounting. It will be only nil because that's as per your accounts. You're supposed to give the figures as per your accounts is what my view is. And fixed assets, whether you show it at cost, WDV or book value. I think here again, you'll show it at book value is what you'll have to show it at. Because the objective is, as I said, in lieu of your filing, they want to know what your financial position. If you're making an application for fresh approval under 80G, further details are to be given for earlier 3 years if expenditure of a religious nature is incurred. And there you have to give what is the total income, what is the expenditure of religious nature, and what is the percentage to total income. And as you know, total income has to be on a commercial basis for this purpose because your calculation under 12A, et cetera, is on a commercial basis. So the purpose of this giving this information is that under 80G, if you're a charitable religious trust, you're allowed to spend not more than 5% on religious purpose, and only then will you be eligible for 80G. So they want to check whether you've exceeded that 5% limit or not, and that is the purpose. Now, if it is debatable whether expenditure is religious or not, then there is no provision for disclosure. So that is the this, problem. So, for instance, today you have a situation where you say that, okay, to propound various philosophies. Now, the philosopher trust may be saying that, okay, we have different philosophies which we propound. Now, if you're diverse philosophy you're propounding, really that is charitable. It is not, it's of general public utility and it's not religious. Religious would mean only of a particular religion, as they say, of involving rituals, etc. So that is a religious thing, is God, the way they looked at it. But there have been decisions, of course, like for instance, teaching of the Vedas, whether that is education or whether that is religious. And there have been tribal decisions saying that, no, that is education. Now, because Vedas is really a way of life, etc., teaches people. And that is highly subjective, frankly speaking, I think. So therefore, I think you have to take a call on this, whether it is religious or not, depending on the way you have to look at whether there is any case on the subject, what is the position which tribunals have taken, or whatever is this, just document it for your internal list, because in case you ask that tomorrow it says you're told that no, this is wrong, and you can point out that no, this is correct because of this information. So this is the view which has been taken. Then along with the Form 10A, what are the documents that you filed? You're required to file self-certified copies of the following. That is your copy of instrument of creation, that is your trust deed or the memorandum and articles. The registration certificate, which is, as I said, for a society, you will have both society registration certificate as well as public trust registration certificate. Enclose both, I think it's advisable. A copy of your registration certificate under FCRA, order granting registration under 12A, 12W or 12AB, because this is a re-registration situation. So you have that valid order. And copies of financial account for 3 years preceding the financial year which the application made. Now, when the return of the earlier year has been filed and this is a re-registration situation, you don't have to file a copy of account for 3 years. That is not required at all. So therefore, at least that hassle is not there, that do I have to include 2021 accounts or not. So you don't have to bother about that because that is not required. If you see the notes to the form, that is the position. In cases of new registration, Form 10A will be accompanied, of course, by the self-certified copies of financial accounts. That is only where you know, a return of earlier year was filed that applies. And here, there's obviously no return of earlier year. And further, if a business undertaking is held in trust in 11-4, so you know, 11-4 is property held in trust. If a business undertaking is held in trust, similarly, so if a business undertaking has been settled upon the trust, then that is what we call as a business undertaking held in trust. So self-certified copies of 3 years of annual accounts and the tax audit report of that business undertaking. Self-certified copies of order rejecting grant of registration under 12A, 12AA or so and so. You know, you may have had your 12A registration rejected earlier and you will have to enclose the self-certified copy of that order of rejection. Even if it was maybe 10 years back, 15 years back, whatever it is, if it was rejected and it was, ultimately, the very fact that you're going for new registration shows that that earlier registration is no longer valid. So because 12A, as you know, was a lifetime registration. So that means you had accepted at that point of time that, yes, accepted that order of rejection, maybe because you're not started your activity, but enclose that, you'll have to enclose that. Whether the question then which arises, whether a new application can be rejected or provisional registration automatic, it seems that it is automatic. But you know, even if it was rejected in earlier years, for 3 years, you will get this. But just take care that if tomorrow you feel that, yes, you may be rejected at the end of when you apply for a regular registration at that point of time, then what will happen, the consequences will be quite severe because you will end up having to pay maybe tax under Section 115TD on the fair market value of the assets at the maximum marginal rate. So therefore, it's something which you have to take great care of, whether that order of rejection was valid or not, take a decision on the basis of that. And you obviously, I mean, there's no question of enclosing any order granting registration 12A, 12AA or 12AB because that was never granted in the past. Then coming to Form 10AB, what are the details you have to give? So besides those details which are given Form 10A, here you're required to give additional details. So details of the school, college or university or hospital, yoga institute, religious places, any other institution being managed or controlled or administered or owned by the applicant. And for that each institution, you're supposed to give name, nature of activity, address, whether it is owned by the applicant, name, contact number, and email ID of the person in charge. Now, I don't know why they want the email ID of the and contact number of the person in charge. So if you have a hospital and they need this of the administrator of the hospital, now why do they need this? I mean, you have the details of the trustee, you have the details of the managing committee members. Why do you want this? I mean, I don't know. I hope this is not subjected to misuse, you know, as we've seen so that is the only. If a business undertaking is property held under trust, you've got to clarify what is the nature of business, the address, and whether separate books of accounts are maintained. You've got to give that, mention that. And because the exemption is available if separate books of accounts are maintained. And if you have any nature in the income in the nature of profit and gains of business, then other than under 11-4, then 11-4A will come into play. And the question here is whether the business is incidental to attainment of objects, what is the nature and address of the business, and whether separate books of accounts have been maintained by the trust. Because these are the conditions that the business has to be incidental to attainment of objectives and separate books of accounts have to be maintained. So that is required for 11-4A, if you want exemption for that business income. And therefore, that is required to be given. Then details of all bank accounts with the IFSC code, account number, name of the bank, etc. And now this is one thing which some trusts may find difficult to give. Details of all land and buildings held by the trust. address, size in square meters, purchase consideration, stamp value at the time of acquisition, mode of acquisition, whether acquired or gifted, that is the mode of acquisition, and date of acquisition. Now, the difficulty is, okay, you may be able to give the address, you may be able to give the size in square meters. Purchase consideration, sometimes you may find it difficult because, you know, your original documents, of course, from that you can get it, maybe. But stamp value at the time of acquisition, what if you got a property 100 years ago? How will you find out? Was there a stamp value? Was there a concept? Was there stamp duty at all in those times? Or if it was 60 years ago, was there stamp duty at all? I think you'll have to leave it blank. I mean, I don't see that, you know, you can't fill it up at all in this. And you'll have to say that, acquired, because obviously you'll say that, date of acquisition, you put the year. Maybe you may, again, not have the exact date, but if you give the year, that should be good enough. I mean, if you say 1896, I'm sure they will not ask you for on what date in 1896 you acquired it. I think the year should be good enough. 1896, 97, or whatever they say, So this is something which, is going to be created. Because, and very often now today, when you get stamp duty, even if, say, once there was a stamp duty valuation, say, in 1987, will you get a stamp duty valuation? What is the value now? And what in 87, will you have that details? You will not have those details. And whether this is to find out whether you're violating 50C or, 56210 really is because it's become a method of getting around 56210, etc. But then you should ask for it, that if it is for so and so date, then only this is relevant, Why do you want to make everybody run around asking, getting for this information is a question, frankly speaking. And then the last point you had mentioned here is in case you have one of your objects is advancement of any other object of general utility, whether it involves carrying on activity in the nature of trade, commerce, or business, or in relation to trade, commerce, or business for a cess, fee, or any other consideration. And whether activities undertaken course of actually carrying out of such advancement of any other object of general public. Now, this is in the context of the proviso to 215. The proviso to 215 says that this will not be regarded as charitable activity if you carry on any activity in the nature of trade, commerce, or business, or in relation to trade, commerce, or business for a cess, fee, or any other consideration, irrespective of how the funds are used. Now, the second point about actual carrying out of advancement of any other object of general public utility. Various courts, including Delhi High Court and other courts, have taken the view that, and tribunals also have read down the proviso to 215, saying that if you're carrying on this activity in the course of actual carrying out of your advancement of objects, then this will not apply. The proviso to 215 will not apply to that. And you're supposed to give details of receipts of from such activity. What is the total receipts, aggregate receipts, percentage to total receipts and remarks. This is to find out whether the proviso applies, whether there's a limit of 20% or 25%, whatever that limit is. Whether that is applies or not, that's the question. Then coming to your 1023C renewal of registration under 1023C. In case of renewal of registration, renewal of provisional registration, making inoperative, what are the documents that you file along with your form 10EB? Similar thing, you will file your registration, trust deed, etc. Accounts for 3 years preceding financial year, which actually is made. And if business undertaking is held in trust under 11-4, your self-certified copies, then 11-4A also accounts of the business and the tax report are required to be filed. But what about cases where litigation is ongoing as to whether it's a business or not? I think you'll have to take a call. Depending on your stand and the appeal on that basis, you will have to say that this is not a business because, and that's the same point which I'm in appeal. If you've amended the trust deed or modified the objects, then the copy of documents evidencing that change, it could be the resolution in the case of a company, it could be the charity commissioner's order in case of a trust deed, or city order of the city civil court in case of a trust deed, or a resolution in case of a society which has been adopted, it has been in two annual general meetings continuously, it has to be adopted. In two general meetings called for the purpose. And a note on the activity. So when you're going for renewal, that is at the end of your 5-year period, that activities of the trust or institution also have to be given. And these other, things are also required to be given. Now, coming to 1023C, you have clauses 4, 5, 6, and 6A where you need an approval from the commissioner today. So there you have to, again, like your 12A, you have to make your application between 1st April 21 to 30th June. and for trusts which fall under clauses 3AB, 3AC, 3AD and 3AE. Now, what are these clauses? 3AB and 3AC are clauses where they're substantially or wholly financed by the government. And 3AD and 3AE are where the gross receipts are less than 1 crore currently. That 1 crore limit has become 5 crore. We'll look at it a little later. But, you know, that so for those cases of trusts, you're still fully exempt. You don't have to go in for any approval, any registration, nothing is required to be done. And for new approval and renewal of approval, same timeline and procedure as for Section 12AB. Only thing that there is no concept of a fresh approval in case of modification or modification of objects, or there's no concept of approval under 1023C becoming inoperative, because once you opt out of 1023C and you go into 12A, then your 1023C is cancelled forever. You know, so that's the way it is. And let's look at the Finance Act, the limits for the changes brought. This is in 3AD and 3AE has those limits where it's contained in Rule 2BC. The limit of 1 crore is if the aggregate annual receipt of such university or hospital or institution. So it's talking about that particular institution and not about the SSC per se. Now the amendment is that the aggregate annual receipts of the person from such university, education institution, or hospital or institution do not exceed 5 crore. So you're talking about the SSC in this case. The SSC's gross receipts from these institutions exceeds 5 crores. And you've got to aggregate educational institutions, medical institutions, aggregate the, all of that together. So if it exceeds 5 crores, then only you're required to apply for a registration you know, under 1023C. Otherwise, you're automatically exempt if the SSC's gross receipts are less than 5 crores. The finance minister's speech in the annexure to part B of the speech is that in order to reduce the compliance burden on small charitable trusts running education institute or hospital, it's proposed to increase the limit from 1 crore to 5 crore for non-applicable various compliances like approval, etc. The explanation also says that you know, in order to provide benefit to small trusts, it's proposed that exemption is increased to 5 crores. Now, but then they said it shall be applicable for an SSC with respect to the aggregate receipts from universities, etc. You know, so therefore that's something which, so if you have a trust, say for instance, take a case like a Velipalli Kerala Remainder, a society. Now there, they are running say maybe 20 or 25 colleges and schools. You have NM College, you have Mithibai College, you have NMIMS, you have Jitendra Chavan College of Law, etc. So you have maybe 25, you have engineering colleges, Sangvi Engineering College or whatever. So you have around 25 such institutions which are run by that earlier, even so there earlier, what happened is that 1 crore limit applied vis-a-vis each of these colleges or institutions. So for each, you know, college, it would be that 1 crore limit. So if it exceeded 1 crore of that, but if NM College exceeded 1 crore, but Mithibai College was less than 1 crore, then Mithibai College did not require approval, but NM College required approval. So that was the way it was. Now they're saying that you aggregate all that, and if it exceeds 5 crores for Velipalli Kerala Mandal itself, then you will have to go in for the registration. So it would could work both ways. If you have a trust which is running only a single institution where the gross receipts are more than 1 crore but less than 5 crore, today that will not require, because it will be less than 5 crore. The total also will be less than 5 crore. So therefore, that's the thing. So in that case, now if you, the trust, now the problem here is that now the trust is required to be approved and not the institution. So therefore, now it will be a, you know, you will require new approval from 1st April 21. And at that point of time, you got to select whether you want to go under 1023 or section 11 and 12, whether you want to go under that. And, you know, so under 11.7, you got to exercise that choice. So whether you renew your 12A registration or now you offer 1023C approval, which was for the colleges, or this would lapse automatically. And now you'll have to, the trust will have to go in for that. Now, institution where the trust, you know, so yeah, so many trusts, you know, they account for the net. If you see the income and expenditure account of many trusts like this, so they show the net income from various institutions in their accounts. Now that, according to me, is not the way you have to look at it. For this purpose, you have to look at the gross receipts of each institution, of all the institutions put together. You can't take the net amounts of all put together. So it's the gross which has to cross 5 crore. If it crosses 5 crore, then that would. You have a rule 2C for 1023C, which is replaced by a new rule. As I said, you also you have a form 10A and 10AB for reapproval and new approvals. For renewal after the end of 5 years or for provisional approval for new cases, it's for provisional approval for renewal of either existing or provisional approvals, but at the end of 5 year period or end of 3 year period, it's the form 10AB. Again, electronically, order granting registration will be granted by principal commissioner, same form 10AC, 16-digit URN. In case of new registration application during financial year 21-22, the provisional registration will be effective from assessment year 22-23. That's clear over here, fortunately. If you make an application in form 10AB where it's a scrutiny, it will be scrutinized, the order of approval, rejection or cancellation will be in form 10AB, similar to 12A. From the original date as similar to 12A, etc. Now let's come to this option under section 11.7. Now what is this option under section 11.7? Where the trust is registered, now this is a provision, today which was already there in the statute books, but there was no proviso to it. So what did it provide so far? It says that where the trust is registered under 12A, 12AA or 12AA, then no exemption is allowable under section 10, except section 10.1 and 10.23C. So that was the provision. Now Finance Act 2020 amended this to say, it added section 12AB over there. And it also said that 1046, no exemption would be allowable except under section 1021, 1023 or 1046 was added over there. Then two provisos have been inserted and this is an amendment with effect from 1st June 2020. There is no change in the date by this Relaxation and Amendment Provisions Act. So this is still from 1st June 2020. This is that the registration will become inoperative from the date on which it is approved under 1020C or notified under 1046. Or the date on which the proviso has come into force, which is 1st June 2020, whichever is later. So if you have applied under, if you have applied for your registration has become inoperative, if you had both 1020C and section 12A registration as of 1st June 2020, then your 12AA registration has become inoperative. That is the position, because this is a procedural amendment. So from that date, it has become inoperative. So thereafter, you will have to claim 1023C. Now you can apply to make it operative under section 12AA, 12AB, and that has to be applied within 6 months prior to the, prior to the beginning of the assessment year, as we saw earlier. So for 22 to 23, you'll have to apply before 30th September 21. You can apply to get it operative. And when you apply, approval under 1020C or notification under 1046 ceases to have effect from the date on which the registration becomes operative. Thereafter, it's not entitled to exemption under those clauses. So, the position is that there's a presumption effectively that 1020C or 1046 is opted for in preference to section 12AA or 12AB. So that has automatically become inoperative. Now you may choose to make it, it operative for the assessment year 22-23 by making that application, but there you'll have to make an application in form 10AB, that is the. So the question then is, can one go back to section 12AA, 12AB? You can go back once to section 12AA or 12AB. Thereafter, you cannot go back to 1023 or 1046. So therefore, once you have opted to come back to section 12AA or 12AB, then you will no longer see your 1046. And the FAQs which are issued on respect of this forms, on this form 10A, there are FAQs which are available on the Income Tax India e-filing website. The FAQs say, one of the points is a trust is already registered under 1023C. It wants to obtain registration under 12A. Is it eligible to file 10A in such a case? And there they're saying, no, if the application is already registered under 1020C, he is not eligible to obtain registration under 12A, and hence he will not be allowed to file 10A for 12A registration. Now, this is, so therefore, only those who had both 12A and 1020C, they can opt to go back into 12AA. So it's a one-time choice that you have to make now. Do you want to go under 11 and 12, or do you want to remain under 1020C? So that is the choice which one has to make. Now, this obviously does not apply to clauses 3AB, 3AC, 3AD or 3A of 1023C. There, that option under the main section still applies because of the fact that you're not approved under 1023C over there. So therefore, there's no approval required over there. and therefore that will you know, option will still available in those cases, I would feel. But so in fact, if you see the explanatory memorandum also, they're saying that there's an anomaly by providing exclusion to institutions registered under 1040C, but same is not available to entity claimant under 1046, and therefore they're saying that okay, 1046 also they can get notified if they're holding under 12A. And however, as the provisions related to charitable entities constitute a complete code, and once any trust or institution has voluntarily opted for it by obtaining the requisite registration, it flows that conditions relation thereto should be complied with and the option of switching and convenience should not be available. Accordingly, if I, while request for exclusion of trade clause 46 may be acceded to for exemption thereunder, even in those cases where registration under 12AA or 12A driven force, there should be only one mode of exemption available. And also that a switching may be allowed only once, so that such switching is not done routinely and also it remains efficient to be administered. So therefore, it's a one-time choice which you have to make now. Either you go under 1020C or you go under 11 and 12. You cannot now switch between the two. So I think, yeah, this is what we've discussed in a sense. So how do you choose between, you know, section 11 and 1020C? How do you choose, you know, and I've given some pointers over here, what are the provisions under each. For audit, both require audit. Accumulation of 15%, both require, allow you to have accumulation of 15%. Option to spend in subsequent year, under section 11, you have that option. Under section 1023, there's no such option to spend in subsequent year. Accumulation for 5 years, both it is there. In 1023, you don't have to file a form for section 11, you have to file a form number 10. The consequence if the accumulation is not spent within 5 years, under 1023, you lose your exemption completely. Under section 11, the unspent accumulation will become taxable in the 6th year. Both under both the provisions, the corpus donation will be exempt. 115TD, interestingly, does not apply to 1023C, but it applies to section 11. That is there. Taxability of anonymous donations, under both anonymous donations are taxed. Exemption for capital gain on reinvestment in the capital asset is not there under 1023C, but it's available under section 11. Restriction on investments is there under both sections. The pattern under section 11, 5, you've got to follow. Restriction on benefit to specified persons is not there under 1020C, but under section 11, it's there. 13.1C, provision 13.1C apply, where you will be denied exemption if you provide a benefit to a specified person. But under 1020C, obviously, you know, if it's shown that you're giving a benefit to a trustee or a, you know, substantial contributor, etc., I'm sure that it will result in a rejection of your application when it comes up for renewal. So you've got to take a choice now. You've got to take a conscious decision what you want to do. Then so far as research institution are concerned, I think I will not deal with it much. It's just a similar procedure. You have now, you know, Form 10A, which you look for reapproval institution. For fresh approvals, there's no change. It's just the form C. There are two forms. It's replaced by one form. But the provision remains the same as it was earlier also. The application has to be made electronically. Otherwise, the procedure is the same as it is today. Then 80G, again, you have a similar thing, which is now coming just like your 12A or 1020C or Section 35. You've got to make the same applications for reapproval. So separate forms you have to file, as I said, for 12AB, for 80G. If you have, say, all 1023, 12AB and 80G, you have to file separate forms for each. But of course, subject to your select between 1023 and 12AB, which one you want to go in for. The approval, again, same thing that when you go, then at the end of 5 years, you have to go for renewal again in apply in Form 10AB. Now, this is something which is a little the same. And for new approvals under 80G, you got to make an application 1 month prior to commencement of pre-issue. Again, the problem is language. But fortunately, here also the rule says that you'll get it from the date of the certificate you to be eligible. You know, that's the thing. So almost similar the provisions are so far as 80G is concerned. So just the point here is that the requirement of renewal every 5 years was done away earlier in 2009. Earlier also it was there for they used to give you for 3 years or 5 years, you had to go back to them. And interestingly, the Finance Act 2009, the explanatory memorandum said that due to the limitation imposed on the validity of such approvals, approved institutional funds have to bear the hardship of getting the approvals renewed from time to time. This is unduly burdensome for bona fide institutional funds and also leads to wastage of time and resources of the tax administration in renewing such approvals in a routine manner. Now, after 10 years, you say that, no, what we said was wrong and now therefore we are going back to this. I think it's a complete about turn, frankly speaking. It's still burdensome for people. It leads to wastage of time and resources which can be used for better purposes. But I think this is the way the government is now trying to control trusts also. You know, it's unfortunate, but the NGO sector is becoming the target of late. That's the... reapproval, the rules you have, I mean, your ATG, you have your existing rule 11AA replaced by new rule, and so separate the thing, as I said, and you get separate approvals. Now, question is whether URNs will be separate is a question mark. I don't, one doesn't know until one is allotted those URNs. In case of new approval application, in case of new approval where you're going in, the provisional approval will be effective from the date of the order. That is the thing. Whereas the ATG5 says, the fourth provision says, from the assessment year following the financial year in which the application is made. So therefore, this at least fortunately, I think, is thing that it will be. The order similarly 10AD will be for the rejection when you make an application form 10AB for renewal. And you can, the cancellation is there, similar this thing, provision is there for cancellation, etc. Then now let's look at this new requirement which has come in about the statement of donations and certificate to be given to donors. These requirements have been inserted with effect from 1st April 21 by the Finance Act 2020. So there's a furnishing of periodical statements in prescribed form. And let's look at what the Finance Minister said and what the explanatory memorandum did. So Finance Minister said that in order to ease the process of claiming deduction, it is proposed to pre-fill the donation information. And this will result in hassle-free claim of deduction. The explanatory memorandum said that there is no reporting obligation. And with advancement technology, it's feasible to standardize the process through which one-to-one matching between what is received and what is claimed as deduction can be made. And it's similar to TDS provisions which and TCS provisions which are already there. And therefore, they will have to furnish a statement and will match it and they will issue a certificate, etc. Just like your TDS and TCS provision. Now, frankly, I think this is, this one-to-one matching, I think, is creating a problem. Form 26 years, as you know, even after, almost 20 years after it has been implemented, we are still facing problems in getting credit for TDS. Now, this problem will be added for ATG also. I think it's something which unnecessary headaches are being added because unless you have a proper foolproof system, it's going to create quite a few difficulties. And expression 2A has been inserted to ATG, which says that the claim of deduction for donation would be allowed on the basis of statement of donations furnished, subject to verification under risk management strategy formulated by CBDT. So I don't know now, just like you have a TDS statement assessment, so will there be an assessment of the statement of donations? I don't know whether that will also happen or you will receive demand, or notices. There's a fee for default relating to the statement or certificate for failure to deliver that statement or certificate. And it's fee of rupees 200 for day. But fortunately, the fee cannot exceed the amount for which the failure occurred. Is to be paid before delivering the statement, it's an additional fee. Is to be paid before delivering the statement of furnishing certificate. It would be 200 per day vis-a-vis each certificate, the way it's worded. I think that's the thing which it will apply. Now, what is the statement of donations? It's in Rule 18AB has been inserted. And they said that the statement should be furnished electronically for each financial year, beginning from financial year 21-22. That is from the current financial year, you will have to file it in Form 10B to be filed by 31st May 2022. Following the financial year in which the donation received. So first one will be due in 31st May 22, fortunately. At least, they've not made it from the last year. But I think one has to ask all our client trust clients to start keeping this information in the specified format so that it will be easy then to file that form. You can file multiple forms 10B, 10DB. Suppose you missed out some donations, etc. You can file multiple forms 10B. While aggregating the amount for determining sums received for report, you have to aggregate vis-a-vis each donor, you've got to aggregate the sums. You have to take into account all donations of same nature paid by that person during the financial year. Proportionately attribute value of donations or aggregate value of all donations to all persons, where donation is recorded in the name of more than one person. So two donors jointly give a donation, then and if they specify 75% is mine and 25% is the second person's, then you will give it, take it 75 and 25, and donations which are received completely, that will be aggregated with that and reflected in this. But where no proportion has been specified by joint donors, then you have to attribute equally to all donors is what you have to do. So if it's in joint names, then you'll have to attribute it equally to all donors. So in this statement of donations, you have to give the UIN, that is what, whether the PAN or the Aadhaar, the section code, whether it's under a statement under 85 ATG or under 35(1), 2, or 3. What is the name of the donor, address of the donor, which you are anyway required to have today. What is the donation type, corpus, it's a specific grant or others. Then what is the mode of receipt? Cash, kind, electronic modes, including account pay, check or draft, or others. Now, if a donor has given different types of donations on in different modes, then separate rows to be shown. So if a donor has given a corpus donation and a, general donation, and he's given some donation in cash and some donation by electronic mode, you may have to show that donor's name 4 times. So that is the requirement. Then you have to give a certificate of donation. Then that they're saying that the deduction will not be available unless the certificate in the prescribed form is issued, and his donation is to be given in form 10B, specifying amount of donation received from the donor during the financial year, but starting from the financial year 21-22. You have to give the certificate by 31st May following the financial year in which the donation is received. So for 21-22, by 31st May 22 is what you will give the certificates, all the certificates. The question is whether the certificate is to be issued to all donors or only to donors whose donation qualify for deduction under Section 80G. Because donations in kind or donations in cash exceeding 2,000 do not qualify. It seems if 80G donation is to be allowed on the basis of statement donations, I don't know what is the purpose of issue of such a certificate. See, so far as this certificate, I think you're really certifying that a person is eligible for 80G in a sense. So I think they will have to issue some clarification on this, because donations in kind and donations in cash exceeding 2,000 are not eligible at all. So issuing certificate would be a misleading thing, and therefore I think it's advisable that there should be, of course, a clarification on this. And just like today, your TDS certificates have lost all meaning because they're giving credit on the basis of 26 years. So you're looking at 26 years and saying, oh, credit is appearing or not appearing, and then you speak to the person, client, etc., ask them that why have you not filed your TDS return, etc. So that's the way it would work now. This is another reconciliation for accountants to do, unfortunately. So this is the form 10BE. This is the format: PAN, name, address, order number granting approval, date of approval notification, the unique identification number, PAN or Aadhaar or other, name of the donor, address of donor, amount of donation received, financial year in which donation received, and type of donation, corpus, specific grants, others, section under which donation is eligible for deduction. So maybe you could issue the certificate, but not take anything at all if it's a donation not eligible under 80G at all. So that's the way one could do it. And then the explanatory memorandum, Finance Act 2020, had given full summary of this. This you can read later. I think it's now coming to the amendments relating to corpus donations and loans, etc., and the application of income. So far, what was happening is that corpus donations were entirely exempt under Section 11A1D, so long as they were made with a specific direction that they shall form part of corpus. And the department was insisting that you please give me, show me the letters from the donors. So that has been the way. And then Karnataka High Court has held that no, so long as, and various other tribunals also have held that, so long as there is evidence to indicate that it was intended for the corpus, that is good enough. It's not necessary that there should be a letter in writing from the donor. That was the EVC. But now, from assessment year 22-23, the exemption will be subject to an additional condition that the donation has to be invested or deposits in the mode specified under Section 11.5, maintained specifically for such corpus. So therefore, now you will need to earmark the corpus donations. So it won't be sufficient just to corpus, show the corpus fund, but investment you show aggregate on the other side. So now you will have to show the corpus donation, and it's advisable to do that now. The expression 4 is inserted that if you spend anything from the corpus, that will not be treated as an application of income. So if you utilize the corpus investments and use it for certain expenses, because to meet the deficit during the year, it's funded out of the corpus, then in that situation, it will not be treated as an application of income. But it will be treated as an application of income in the previous year in which the amount is invested or deposited in the mode specified in Section 11.5, maintained specifically for such corpus, to the extent it is invested. So therefore, when you put it back as earmarked investments of corpus, earmarked corpus investments, in that year, it will be treated as an application of income. Similarly, in 1023C, you have a similar amendment. So therefore, now you will have to keep a track of the movement in the corpus investment. And starting point would be balance of corpus fund and corpus investments as on 31st March 2021. So therefore, I would suggest that as of March 21 itself in the balance sheet, one should earmark corpus investment separately from the other regular investments. It's something which will be there. And any reduction of investments will have to be reduced from the application of income for that year. Any addition to investments over and above corpus donations for that year, you will have to treat it as an addition to the application of income for the year. That's the. And there is no time limit for recoupment of corpus investment. So even after 10 years, if you spend in year 1 and year 10, you put back that money into corpus investments, then that in that year 10, you will get it as an application of income. So that's the good part of it. Let's look at it, understand this. Let's take a situation where you receive a corpus donation of 10 lakhs in June 21. invested for a 1 year bank fixed deposit in July 21. And the fixed deposit was encashed in July 2022 and used for acquiring an asset. And as you know, acquisition of an asset is also capital expenditure on objects. I assume it's for your objects. Corpus donations of 15 lakhs were received during that year in financial year and invested in the bank fixed deposits in financial year 22-23. And corpus donations of 5 lakhs were received during financial year 23-24. And additional bank fixed deposits of 11 lakhs were invested during that year, incremental amount. So including this 5 lakhs, so total 11 lakhs were invested over and above the opening investments. Now, the first corpus donation which you received of 10 lakhs, it has been invested in the same year. So in the balance sheet, it appears. So therefore, it will be exempt under 11-1D in the year in which you receive that donation. In year two, what happens? You receive 15 lakhs corpus donation. You invested those in bank fixed deposits. But you encashed a fixed deposit of 10 lakhs and you spent it on acquiring an asset. Now this 10 lakhs, then you will show the capital expenditure on objects, but you will reduce, you will not include that expenditure which is included of that. So capital expenditure objects less 10 lakhs, which is out of corpus investments, and therefore the expenditure cap that will be nil over there. So that is the way you will have to do it. So therefore it will be reduced from your total expenditure, including capital expenditure. And now in year, the next in assessment year 24-25, that is financial year 23-24, what happens? You received corpus donations of 5 lakhs. Against that, you have made fixed deposits of 11 lakhs. Now, this corpus donation of 5 lakhs is exempt because you invested 5 lakhs during the same year. And you made further corpus donation of 6 lakhs, which is recoupment of the earlier 10 lakhs which you have spent. So therefore, 6 lakhs will be treated as an application of income for charitable or religious purposes in assessment year 24-25. So that is the way I think this would work. And the same thing applies so far as loans are concerned, where the provision now is that the application from loan or borrowing is not to be treated as an application of income for charitable or religious purposes. It would be treated as an application of income in the previous year in which the loan is repaid from income of that year to the extent that it is repaid. So let's take a year. In year one, you've taken a loan of 50 lakhs and you spent 50 lakhs. Now in that year, the 50 lakhs is not to be treated as an application of income. But in year two, you paid back say 5 lakhs or 10 lakhs out of that loan. Then in year two, you will get 10 lakhs as an application of income in that. So today what was happening is they felt that you're getting a double deduction because repayment of the loan was also eligible. Deficit was also eligible. You were also able to claim that as an application of income in that year one itself. That was the so similar amendments are there in 1023C as well. And carry forward of deficit, you know, you had the Supreme Court decision in the case of Subro's Educational Society, where the Supreme Court had held that deficit of the trust can be carried forward. You know, though there is no process specific provision on commercial basis, you can carry it forward. And in fact, if you look at the tax return format for assessment year 2021. It, you know, in Schedule ER and in Schedule EC, which is the expenditure, revenue and expenditure capital, there you had, you have to show five items, the sources of funds. So income derived from property during the year, income deemed as application in previous year under Clause 2, Expression 1, income from earlier accumulated, 15% accumulated, borrowed funds and any other. And what they would say is that the 2, 3, 4 and 5, were to be reduced from the total revenue expenditure, so therefore they would not be regarded as a revenue expenditure during the year. So this was, I think, I would saying that, you know, effectively they would not, so similar to this borrowing fund and all, it was precursor to this amendment coming. The expression 5 has been inserted with effect from assessment year 22-23, that no set off or deduction for deficit of earlier years is allowed. So therefore this ratio of the Supreme Court decision is reversed. So that is the position. Now, a few issues which arise on this is that within what period do I make the investment of corpus, immediately or by year end? I think it's by year end is good enough. Just as for capital gains, you can invest it so far as within the financial year itself. So you have to look at it from balance sheet to balance sheet. That's the way I would look at it. Would deposit in the current account of the bank qualify? Yes, that is also a deposit in a scheduled bank mentioned under Section 5. There's a Madras High Court decision to that effect. Earmarking, I said that's there. Now, how long do you maintain the corpus investment? You've got to maintain it indefinitely in case you are spending it, as I said, that, it will not be regarded as an application of income. So if you don't maintain that. What if you receive a corpus donation, deposit in the bank account and spend it in the same year? Whether it will be a double hit because this will not be regarded as corpus donation since you've not invested it. And at the same time, the expenditure will not be allowed because it's out of corpus donation. Is that the position? No, I think there you will get the expenditure will be treated as an application of income because then this will not be a corpus donation exempt under Section 11-1D. So one will take a stand that this is not a corporate which is exempt under Section 11(1)(d), and therefore this will, the application of income of this will be a regular income, and therefore application of income will be eligible. Then what about receipt of assets other than immovable property by way of corpus donation or corpus donations received for acquiring such assets? Say for instance, you have a medical trust which receives a gift of an ambulance, or a trust, temple trust receives some jewelry for the deity. What happens there? Now there again the same thing. I would say that possibly one would say that this is not a corpus donation because it has not been invested in the specified deposit. You know, immovable property is there under 11(5), but no. No other assets, others are all investments, basically. So, therefore, an ambulance would not be a permitted investment under 11(5), but it would be an expenditure on objects. And therefore, the corpus donation would be treated as a taxable one, but again, that you will be able to claim as an application of income to the extent of the cost of the ambulance. Similarly, the jewelry, the same thing. If you have corpus donations, you know, building fund you have, and if it's invested in immovable property and you provide depreciation on immovable property, what happens over a period of time, a mismatch starts occurring. And there, I think it's advisable that, you should find, there are two alternatives that. One is that you create a depreciation fund and reflect the immovable property at its original cost. That is one option. Or the second option is you show the immovable property gross cost, less depreciation till the end of the early year, less depreciation for the year. I think that's the way you should show it, so that you can match the fund with the investment in the immovable property. That's something which you should do, so that the mismatch does not arise over the period of this. And there should not be an allegation that you've utilized corpus donations for. Where existing corpus is already utilized in the earlier, investments are not matching, whether recoupment of corpus can be claimed. And if similarly, what if your deficit of earlier years was financed by a loan and loan is now repaid? Now the deficit, you're not getting it, brought forward of the deficit not allowed. So therefore, repayment of a loan, I think, if it was represented by a deficit, I think you should be able to claim the recoupment of corpus and the repayment of the loan as well. I think it should be something which should be eligible. That's the way I would look at it, of the fact that, the existing corpus, when it was utilized, at that point of time, okay, the law was different, today the law is different, but yes, the recoupment of corpus is now permissible under this, and therefore you should be able to get it. Well, I think that completes what I wanted to cover, and now we can, for the next 15-20 minutes, we can take question answers. Thank you all for a very patient hearing. Mr. Khandelwal, I think you're on mute.
Thank you, sir. Now I'll ask C.S. Trivedi to take up the questions. He'll read the questions and you please try to answer them.
Sure.
Yeah. Sure, sir. So before we move on to the questions in the Q&A box, we have already some advanced questions that participants have sent us. I'll just take that up first, and maybe then we can move to the questions in Q&A box. So, sir, we move to the first question. What about the trust who have registered on under Section 12AA and ATG in the month of March 21? Whether they need to follow the new procedural aspects?
Yes, they have to apply for re-registration.
Correct. Thank you so much. Moving on. Second question. Some of the trusts were very old trusts, say 60 to 70 years old, and copy of the trust deed is not available. What precautions and actions need to be taken, presuming that they will have to present the same in 5 years?
I think here, this is a practical difficulty faced by many trusts, because sometimes you have trusts which are 100 years old, sometimes, but this is something which you need to take action. Try and get a copy of the trust deed from the charity commissioner or wherever you're registered. I think they would be having probably a copy of that. And very often we've seen that the charity commissioner does provide a certified copy of the trust deed, which one should try and get. That's the only way I think I can.
Sure.
Sorry to interrupt. Even charity commission does not have a copy of that.
Oh, then I think there is a bit of a problem. I mean, you'll have to explain why the trust deed is not available. And this, because see, today they want to check your trust deed. They want to check what are your objects. How do you know what your objects are? When the 12AA was granted to you, did you not have your trust deed? How did they check, verify your objects? Let's understand that. if you are registered under 12AA already, how did they verify your objects?
Yes, sir.
There was some way to for them to verify.
But this is a practical problem now. Trusted is not available with charity commissioner also.
Then would it be with the income tax department when you had filed it for, now of course getting from income tax department any document is a real challenge, I think.
Yes.
But this is something which the very fact that you've got your 12AA registration means in the 1960s at least, when the requirement of registration came in, no, sorry, 1970s, when that requirement of registration came in, at that point of time you had your trust deed, it seems.
Yes, sir.
One will have to, I think you'll have to then say that, okay, this is not available, or now, therefore, if once you say it is not available, this is an oral trust, it may be rejected. That is a practical difficulty which one will have to, therefore. So therefore, one has to try and make full efforts to see whether you can get hold of it somehow.
Thank
and
you.
The pandemic doesn't help things any, unfortunately. You know, it's creating more problems because you can't move out also. And let me give you a practical this thing. I had a situation where one of our trusts, they said, we don't have a copy of our 12A registration certificate, for instance. You know, it was given way back in 1973, that 12A registration certificate. So we found out that the application was from old files, that application was filed in 71. So then we sent somebody to the income tax commissioner's office, and there were four or five big registers. So one of the article clerks sat and went through all the registers one by one from 1970 onwards, from the date the application was made, and finally was able to trace it, and we applied for a duplicate certificate and got that certificate. But these are the practical difficulties, I think, which one faces, but one will have to the thing, because see, those days are gone where you can say that no, I'm registered, I don't have a copy, but I'm registered, and that's what they want to stop. The people have been claiming, and very often many of these trusts have not been actually registered also. They've been just claiming over the years, and that's where the difficulty lies.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Sure, sir. Moving on. So I think this question we discussed before the session started, but for the benefits of member, I'll repeat it. So whether trusts are required to modify their trust deed as per the new guidelines when they will re-register after 5 years?
Yeah, on the revocability clause, I think it's safer. I would suggest that it's safer to do that modify your trust deed. Though, if they clarify that a resolution is good enough, then that should be fine. But unless that comes, then I think we should apply for modification of your trust deed. Maybe after a year or so, you should do that to bring in that irrevocability clause. And sure. Say that on dissolution, so say that it is irrevocable, but on dissolution, the assets can be transferred to any other trust or institution having similar objects. So that is the.
So I think next two questions are connected to AOP. Maybe you want to take it now or later. I'll just read it out. Which ITR form an AOP is required to file, and whether corpus donations are taxable in case of an AOP or not?
I think we are not dealing with AOP. A trust is not an AOP. Let me be clear. The status of a trust as held by Bombay High Court is that of individual. Bombay High Court, Calcutta High Court, any number of high courts have taken the view that the status of a trust is that of individual. So it's not an AOP, firstly. And this question relates to AOP. So I don't think, it's trust here. So we're not talking about AOPs.
Fair enough. Sure, sir. So moving on, whether accounts of last 3 years are not submitted at the time of revalidation. I think this question is something incomplete. I mean, whether the accounts of last 3 years are not submitted at the time of revalidation. So what should be the course, I think, is what they want to ask.
No, see, you're not required to give your accounts if you file your return for assessment year 2021 and you apply for re-registration. The financial accounts for last 3 years are not required to be filed, provided you file your return. If you've not filed your return, then you're required to file those accounts, as well as you're required to give the status of financial assets and decide on the date of application, or as close thereto as possible.
Yeah, I think next question is a continuation of the earlier question. I think that was incomplete. So what steps to be taken if a trust has not filed its accounts and has been non-compliant for about 3 years and the trustees are not meeting regularly, or if some of the trustees are not keen to carry forward the activities?
I think this is a practical difficulty. In this case, this trust may not be able to apply for renewal or for re-registration in this case, unless you are able to get their accounts ready for this 3 years, last 3 years, and not only last 3 years, but the financial position as of a recent date, that's one, and apply. Otherwise, they will have to then allow the registration under Section 12A to lapse, and then you know, apply for new registration later on. I think that's the only way in which.
Sure. So these were the questions posted pre-session. So I'll take up the questions during the session that have come up. So the question is, in Form 10AB, it is specifically asked in row number 6 whether the trust deed contains the clause that is trust is irrevocable. If the trust does not have an irrevocability clause in the trust deed, can the commissioner deny the revalidation of section 12AA and 80G? Also, the question goes
re-registration is not a problem. Re-registration is not a problem. According to me, that is automatic. But this question will come up when it comes, in Form 10AB, when you go. This is there in both Form 10A as well as 10AB. So in Form 10AB, when you go at that point of time, this, as I said, therefore, it's advisable to get your trust deed amended in that situation.
Sure.
To avoid litigation. Otherwise, right. I mean, it will succeed, but with litigation.
And also the case will be the same with the provisional registration for the new trust?
Yes, provisional registration for new trust also will be the same. You will be granted provisional registration, but then you will have 3 years time to, or when you, before starting, at, I mean, within 6 months of starting activities, when before you make your fresh list, you'll have to amend the trust deed to incorporate that.
The next question is, can an incubator invest in shares of an incubatee?
Sorry?
Can an incubator invest in shares of an incubatee?
See, an incubator, which is a trust thing and, registered as a charitable trust, I think this is a practical difficulty. You are not allowed to invest in shares. 11.5 does not permit investment in shares. I think there is, under 11.5, there are certain notified assets. So we'll have to see that notification, the notifications of the assets. There are some, which is, for instance, for a stock exchange, they have given certain certain things which they have. Incubator, I think, is not there. Yeah, incubator is there. Yeah, incubator, investment made on or after 1st March 2007 by way of acquiring shares of an incubatee by an incubator. And so if you see notification is there for that under section 11.5. If you look at the act, they've given by way of a footnote, the rule 17C. Sorry, rule 17C has this. So incubator can invest in shares of an incubatee. So that is permitted under 11.5.
Taxability of donations by one trust to other trust out of the normal income as a normal donation or a corpus donation to other trust.
See, normal donation to another trust, there is no problem. This will be treated as an application of income for the donor trust and it will be regarded as regular income for the donee trust. If you give to the corpus of the donee trust, then the donee trust, it will not be taxable. But for the donor trust, it will not be an application of income as per the amendment.
Correct. Sure. Moving on, what are the documents to be uploaded for new registration under section 12AB if upload in the upload section provided in the form?
See, I've given that list, this one, in my presentation, which will be shared with you. So it has the list. So there's a whole slide on that.
Sure. Moving on. In case of some very old trust, it is very difficult. I think it is a repeated question.
Old documents is a problem for some trusts. We have to find some practical way to get around that.
So since pandemic is going on for self-certification, can we put trustee's digital signature over the documents?
I think that should suffice because digital signature is also a signature.
What will be the consequences if Form 10A filed when the option to attach attachment of required documents are not available on the income tax website?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
What will be the consequences if Form A file when the option to attachment of required documents are not available on the income tax website?
It's there. See, if you scroll down in the form, when you fill up the form completely, at the bottom there are those buttons are there. And you click on those buttons and it will ask you to select the file which you want to attach. For each of those, so copy of creation of instrument of trust, certificate of registration. So all those buttons are there. You've got to click on those buttons and select the concerned file.
Sure, sir. Thank you. So, moving on, whether approved group gratuity scheme whose income is exempt under Section 1025 have to file for re-registration in the new.
No, scheme. This is only for charitable and religious trusts. So, 1023C, Section 35 and Section 12A. That's all.
Moving on, if a trust which was formed in 2020 but did not apply for 12AA registration, will it have to apply for provisional registration and then final registration the activities have already started by the trust.
So trust is formed in 2020 and
not applied for registration.
So there will be a new registration situation from 1st April 21. It will have to apply for new registration.
An assessee whose 12A was rejected earlier by commissioner, can he now apply for re-registration for 12AB under new provisions?
Yes, he can apply. But if it was, you know, if it was the rejection was only because of, say, for instance, not starting of activities, then fine, you know, there should not be a problem. But otherwise, what will happen is you'll get your provisional registration for 3 years. And at the end of 3 years, they'll say, okay, now you pay tax at the maximum marginal rate. And now we are rejecting you all because on the same grounds, and you know, we'll tax you at the maximum marginal rate under 115TD also. So that is the problem which may arise if it was for other reasons. So therefore, you have to look at what were the reasons for rejection. Do those reasons for rejection, were they valid? Do they still continue to hold good? If that is the position, then I think one has to be a little...
Sure. So in case of existing trust where registration was never taken, can they also be considered as a fresh registration, or is it better to set up a new trust and apply? They will be anyway carrying on the activity as well even before the registration. So in this case, is it better to apply within 6 months of provisional registration?
It will be like a fresh registration. So the same trust can apply for fresh registration.
Yeah. In case of... In case of Section 8 company, whether trust is irrevocable, should the answer be no?
See, Section 8 company, answer should be yes, trust is not revocable. Yes, answer should be no. Because if you see your memorandum article, you have a clause over there which says that it shall be given to another organization having similar this thing, etc. It's one of the things.
So if you are having 12A as well as ATG, whether submitting form 10A one time would suffice the requirement, or should you submit it two times?
I think the person has not heard what I have spoken, I think, all along. So should I repeat the whole lecture? Maybe. This was a very clear signal. I thought that you have to file separate forms for each. So 12A separate, 1020C separate, ATG separate, 35 separate.
Correct. Sure. Whether we need to give name of the trustee who is appointed, but the change report is not filed.
Yes, because he is a trustee, no? And for your, if you are regarding him as a trustee, then I think you should, give his details.
Sure, sir. Moving on. Application is to be made in Form 10B, but the Form 10B is not available in e-file income tax forms. Form 10A is available for e-filing. Do we have to make application in Form 10A instead of 10B? How to make application for re-registration?
10B is the audit report form, no? Sorry, 10AB you mean?
I think maybe there is a time.
10AB, you have time to make that the thing, because you have to apply in 10AB. You know, it's not right away that you have to apply in 10AB. You can still file it a little later. It's only for re-registration that you've got to file, which is in Form 10A right now. So renewal of registration or cases where you want to opt for this, that is by 30th September you have time, no? So therefore, probably it will come in the next month or two. It will come in on the site. So right now, they are first focusing on the 10A forms.
I think this is a repeated question. In Form 10A, there is no provision to upload attachments. I think
there is at the bottom. Please look at the form carefully. Scroll down and you'll find, this.
The Society and Association of Person, again, this is the AOP related question, is neither registered under Section 12A or 12AA nor ATG. Is it advisable?
Are you talking about a housing society? Housing society is different. Please don't mix up housing society and a society registered under Societies Registration Act 1860. So cooperative housing society is something quite different.
Sure. So can a non-resident, non-citizen of India be a trustee of the charitable trust under Bombay Charitable Trust Act?
I think that's the same, because there, like this, I can speak for 15-20 minutes on this. Just look at Section 46A of the Maharashtra Public Trust Act. That's all I would say. All
right. Sure. A charitable trust is having object of taking senior citizens to pilgrimage from pleasure tours. Will it be eligible for exemption under Section 11?
Depends on what is the thing, you know, to whom you are giving that benefit. If the benefit is being given only to, certain close persons, etc., then it may amount to, that you are not really carrying on charitable activity. But if the benefit is being given to poor and needy people who have an income level exceed below a particular level, etc., then one can justify it, you know. So that is
sure. whether for re-registration of trust accounts for the year ended 31st March 21 is required to be filed.
Accounts are not required at all if you filed your return for assessment year 2021. Accounts are not required at all. Neither 3 years accounts are required nor the latest year accounts are required.
Whether for trust not having ATG certificate, having religious and charitable object, whether religious expenses exceeding 5% is allowed?
No, that you will not get ATGs. See, you can spend, but if you don't have ATG, you can spend for both religious and charitable. The only thing is you will not get ATG. 12A will, 11 and 12 is not a problem. It's only ATG which is a problem.
What is the nature of activity of an incubator? Is it educational or any other objects of general public utility?
I think it's like any other objects of general public utility, you know, incubator, because they want to facilitate business. So therefore it will be, you know, promoting trade, commerce and industry really.
If trust is claiming exemption under section 1023C as well as section 11, which one is advisable to continue? What are the differences between the two sections?
Yeah, please refer to that slide which I have, a slide I have given the 12 to 15, this thing. I think the person was not there when that slide was presented possibly.
If a trust is registered under section 12A and filed form 10A for registration, re-registration, and the same is submitted, they also have ATG certificate. Does they have to file any separate form for ATG re-registration or submission of final form is automatic?
Yes, you'd file a separate form again in form 10A for ATG, but select in the drop-down menu that the relevant clause of ATG, which. So one form 10A, which is under 12A, that's a code one, which is there, which is the re-registration. And the second one, under ATG, the relevant seek for re-registration, you have to select. So two separate forms, but giving this code different. Everything else will be the same. It will be a mirror, the thing. Everything else will be the same.
Sure. 12AA registration received in last financial year, but ATG not yet received through, though applied for in March 21. What's to be done in such case?
I think your ATG will be treated as an automatic application under the new provisions. So therefore, I think it's something which you can check whether it's available there or not. So that's the way it should be regarded as an automatic thing. So far as your 12A is concerned, you'll have to apply for re-registration. ATG, you know, it's like a new application under the new provision is what they said they'll treat it. I don't think you have to file it again, but it's better that you check with the concerned commissioner that, yes, I had filed this and this is pending. So what is to be done? Commissioner's office, one will have to check that.
Sure. If in initial application, settlor who is also a trustee and his details are only filed as a settlor and not again as a trustee, does this need to be rectified and how is it to be done?
Unfortunately, there is no provision for rectification of the form as yet. You know, that's the whole problem. Maybe one can check whether, you know, one can file another form also for the same, you know, so that's, whether they will accept another form under 12AA is something which one will have to check maybe with the commissioner's office, and he will check maybe the DG systems whether this is possible. But at least you've disclosed the name, and if you mention both settlor and trustee against him, then well and good. But if you mention only trustee and not settlor, then perhaps there could be an thing. But see, the objective, I think, is to identify the purpose persons who are under 13(1)(c) applicable, and maybe one can say that, okay, his name has been disclosed, but only one designation has been shown. It's actually two designations, really. So right. Technically, I mean, it's just a technical violation. I think one should not worry too much about it. But if you're filing a fresh application, I mean, today you're not yet filed the application, then take care that you show his name twice.
Sure.
I think Shreyas is having
Shreyas might be having some technical issues. Sure, I think I'll take. Just give me a moment. I'll take up the question. Trust is formed in 1958. Registration under Bombay Public Act having 12A registration and first return is filed for AY 2021. Can it apply for 12AB registration? What will be the effect if application is rejected? A trust is having immovable property.
Why should it be rejected? Okay, you're saying that, so they filed the return for 2021 claiming exemption or not? That's the question. because possibly they file the return not claiming exemption, correct? So if it is rejected that means it's a new application. Therefore, you'll have to file in Form 10AB. Once you file in Form 10AB, it's a new application. You're not registered under 12A earlier. Even if it's rejected, there is no consequence, I see. Because if you were registered under 12A and then the registration is cancelled, that's when your 115TD applies. Here in this situation, 115TD will not apply because you were never registered under 12A.
While applying for PAN, whether we have to choose the trust as AOP or individual? Because I think somewhere you mentioned that it is taxed as an individual. That is
right. I'll tell you where the problem really is. And unfortunately, you know, I think very often I think that the income tax department also does not understand the law and the thing. There are, as I said, any number of high courts, Bombay High Court in Shardavan Bhagwai Mufatlal Trust 247 ITR1, where Bombay High Court has clearly held that the status of trustees of a charitable trust is that of individual. There is the Calcutta High Court decision in the case of Sri Krishna Bhandar Trust 203 ITR, where Calcutta High Court has said that the trustees of a discretionary trust that in that situation are individual, and a charitable trust is really a discretionary trust in that sense. So, and there are any number of decisions on to that effect. In fact, at one point of time, I remember there was the CBDT had issued a circular also saying that, you know, when you had to, the e-filing was made mandatory. They had said that, you know, the people have said that the trust status of trust is individual and should they have to e-file, etc. And they've said that, no, in such cases, it will be, you can go on the basis of individual and on that basis, you don't need to e-file, etc. So, therefore, unfortunately, but the law, unfortunately, does not provide. And the only thing that they say, oh, there's AOP into bracket trust, and which people select in the return. I mean, you have no choice, frankly speaking, because you're filling up Form 7. It doesn't accept individual, unfortunately. That's the your form itself, rather, you can't file your return at all. And therefore, you're forced to choose AOP into bracket trust. So, but, you know, when you're claiming any this thing, benefit, etc., you can certainly say that, no, this was wrong. You know, this I had no choice but to file the return in this. And this issue has come up in the case of venture capital funds, you know, the India Advantage Fund, the Karnataka High Court decision, Bangalore Tribunal and Karnataka High Court. And then there are a number of other, this thing, now Madras High Court also has taken, where just because you selected a wrong status does not mean that, you know, that is your status. You can still argue that your correct status is that, this. You know, that's the.
Another question is related to FCRA. Any update on FCRA opening a bank account with SBI from 1st April 2021?
And that was mandatory. You can't accept foreign donations now from 1st April 21, you know, unless you have your that SBI bank account. I don't think they've extended it.
Yeah. In fact, there was a follow-up question whether they can accept donations. So I think you've answered it already. Then in case trust does not wish to re-register and discontinue, what should be the course of action? First register and then apply for deregistration, or not apply for re-registration?
Don't apply for re-registration at all. I think that's the safer case.
Of existing four trustees, one trustee is expired. How to proceed with re-registration? Do need to amend the deed first?
Sorry, out of four trustees, one trustee has
expired. So how they can proceed for re-registration? Whether they need to amend the deed first?
Only three trustees. Give the name of three trustees. One trustee who is expired is obviously not a trustee any longer.
Okay. Do you have any information how many Form 10A filled in April 21 for registration? Re-registration. I think this may not be information. The gentleman is asking how many Form 10A have been filed in April 21 for re-registration. I don't think you are from Income Tax Department to answer this, but if still you have any clue, you may answer.
How do you file?
His question is, how many re-registrations have been filed, sir? Hello? Yudhiraji, I think we have lost Gautam, sir, also. Hello?
No, sorry. I lost you. What did he say? How did you?
He's asking whether how many re-registrations have been filed in April 21 with the Income Tax Department, sir.
I think you can ask the commissioner, concerned commissioner, or you can approach them and find out what is the position. But I think, you know, at least in my office, I know that there have been three or four cases where we have filed already. And in fact, one of them, they received an email saying that your approval number null, the thing is there, and please comply with condition number so and so. And he went and he said there's nothing there, which is, you know, no certificate as yet. So I said that just like SSEs are having teething problems with the new provisions, even the department is having teething problems understanding the new provision under the new procedure.
I think rest all questions have been answered during your presentation. So I think we will end the question answer session now. And I will hand over the reins to Giriraj ji for now.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Pradeep. Thank you, Gautam sir, for your excellent session and excellent presentation. Your presentation will definitely clear doubts of all the participants today. With this, I request Pradeep Chandwani, our deputy convener, to propose a hearty vote of thanks to the speaker.
Thank you, Giriraj ji. We are very thankful to CA Gautam Nayak sir for giving us a very wonderful presentation today. At the outset, I think Giriraj ji had said that department is not trusting our trust, but I am sure after listening to Gautam sir, at least our trust clients will have full faith and full trust in us, so that we are in our position to answer all trust related queries. I think he has given a very detailed and excellent presentation today, and not only that, he has answered all the questions with very calm and composure and detail. We are very thankful to you, sir. Well, we are thankful to you, sir, from BCSC and from our members. With this, a very round round of applause for CA Gautam.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I think with this, we'll end the session, sir. Thank you very much once again for all members for attending the session.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Bijal, can you close the meeting? Because I'm not the host.